Awesome. All right, then. Let's start. All right. My name is Nicholas. Here with Team Rajpal. I want to introduce you to our special guest, Mohit Masand. All right. He is from Dominic Lending. And I'm going to let him take it away. We're basically going to be talking about mortgage qualifications during this COVID-19.
Hi, Nick. Thank you so much. How are you?
Good, good. How's your family doing? And how are you?
All good. We are all struggling with being at home at the same time, like everyone else.
Yes.
How's your family doing?
Getting a little bored at home, but at least we can go out and eat. At least the York region has opened up in stage
yes.
three now, so
yes.
We can go out and eat or get.
That's super important. No, absolutely. Thank you for having me today, and wanted to speak with you guys about say mortgage qualification during COVID-19, how things have changed. I get a lot of questions from people from within the industry and even outside of it, people who are planning to buy or refinance, and they have a question as to whether I would qualify during COVID-19 or not. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of myths making the rounds as well. So I'd like to make sure that we've all got the right information and we're all on the same page. So before I do that, I can give you, if you don't mind, a quick introduction to what I do, my profile. Mm-hmm. Like Nick said, I'm a licensed mortgage agent, and I'm associated with a franchisee of Dominion Lending Centers. It's called Affinity Mortgage Solutions. Dominion Lending Centers, by the way, is one of the biggest mortgage companies across Canada. And we've got over 6,000 agents, mortgage agents from coast to coast. Back in 2018 and 2019, I was the recipient of Dominion Lending Center's Sales Achievement Award. It is awarded to, obviously, the top sales performers in that particular year. Mm-hmm. And the way things are going, hopefully, I have that in 2020 as well. In terms of my experience, I have been in the industry for close to about 5 years now. And, I've been dealing with a lot of different client situations. Just in the last 2 years, I've had about 342 client situations that I've dealt with, existing clients and potential clients. And what that's done for me is it's given me a holistic picture of the kind of products that are available out there. It's one thing to say, that's my next point, that we have over 230 lenders, but every situation is different, and how we can accommodate those situations and get them a mortgage is something that all of these existing and potential clients have helped me with their different questions and situations. And as I mentioned, as a part of Dominion Lending Centers, I have over 230 lending institutions that we work with, right from banks to credit unions to trust companies and private investors. So that's with regards to what we've got. Just again, one clarification, we work with A, B, and private lenders. Mm-hmm. So when I say A lenders, what I mean is prime lenders. These prime lenders are, let's say, banks. As an example, we work with Scotia Bank and TD Bank on the broker channel. But apart from that, we also have other prime lenders who'd give you, the same rate as the bank, if not better, and sometimes even better terms and conditions in terms of prepayment, etc. So some of the other lenders, just to name a few, are MCAP. You may have heard of some Meridian, First National, even Equitable Bank on the A side. We've got all of those people that we work with. And on the B side, so B lenders or subprime lenders are a little more flexible with their requirements. And, we have Equitable Bank on the B side, Home Trust, IC Savings, Community Trust, etc. And then we have, if nothing works out, worst case scenario, we also have private investors. And sometimes we tend to use it if the credit's extremely bad and they want to consolidate their debt, which is currently at like 21%, they've got credit card debt. We can consolidate that through a private mortgage as well, if need be. And that's only worst case, as I said. Now let's dive right in terms of how things have changed. So the first thing that I'd like to talk about is changes in how your employment is going to be verified by the lender. So let's take the first example, full-time permanent employees. Now, this is the bread and butter for most mortgage people. We love full-time permanent employees because, there are standard set of documentation that we can get You know, and there's very rarely do we, you know, have surprises. Full-time permanent, they've been working at this company for a little while, they've got either hourly or salary, and we're good to go. However, during COVID-19, the lenders have started asking for a couple of additional documents over and above the regular employment letter, pay stubs, last year's T4, etc. What they've also started doing now is they've started asking for bank statements to confirm deposits. This is especially the case if you're working with a smaller company. So I'd give you an example. I am working with a borrower right now, and the deal is placed with one of the non-banking prime lenders that we have. And they've asked for bank statements to confirm deposits because one of the borrowers works with a small, dental clinic. So as soon as you have like smaller companies that the lenders don't readily recognize, they'll ask for bank statements to confirm that the pay is going in. That's one. They would also do a verbal confirmation of income, which means that the lenders are going to call, in most of the cases, they are going to call the employer, not just to make sure that the information we've provided is accurate, but also to ensure that the office is open and the employee is working on full-time hours. So if the office did close because of COVID, that's fine as long as it's resumed now and your full-time or the borrower's full-time hours have resumed. In certain cases, like I said, non-banking financial institutions with the banks, once they have done their verbal confirmation, even if it's, let's say, three months before closing, they're good to go. In certain non-banking prime institutions, they would perhaps do verbal confirmation a couple of times. Like in the deal that I just quoted to you, there's a verbal confirmation that's happened, and there's going to be one more about 10 days before closing. I'm not concerned because I know that these employees have steady income and they're back to work, etc. But this is a conversation that we are having with clients, and we want to make sure that their office is open full time and their income is steady right now.
Okay. Also, I just want to throw out there for those joining us, just joining us on Facebook Live and also Zoom. You have any questions, feel free to type it in the comments, and then I'll be sure to read out to Mohit for him to address anything. Continue, Mohit. I just wanted to throw it out there just in case.
No, absolutely. Thank you. So that's with full-time permanent employees. Like I said, not much difference in terms of how you were being qualified. Just add a couple of additional steps to make sure that, things are in place. You know, they may search up your office as well. And if on Google, it says that your office is currently closed because of COVID, or if you're getting offices open part-time only, that may certainly be a question that would be asked to me. And then eventually I'll have to clarify with you. So those are things that we have to be ready for. There are certain employees who've got reduced income. Now, reduced income could be in various different ways. So I was working with one of my clients recently. He works with an accounting firm, one of the top firms actually, and at an executive level. And he's voluntarily agreed to reduce his income. He started in May and it'll end in September. And his closing is in October. So when we put the deal in the system, we got an exception to use his full income, 100% of his income, with the condition that when he resumes full-time work in September, we'd send a pay stub and a new employment letter to the lender to confirm that full-time income has resumed. However, if there is no ending date, and if it's said that you are on fewer hours or reduced income for now, then it's always case by case. So let me give you an example. If we can get an employment letter from a lender, and that's, again, a live situation, a live deal that I'm working on, where the borrower is on reduced days. So they're working 4 days out of five every week. So instead of working 5 days, they're working 4 days. The number of hours have reduced to 32. Now that's pretty straightforward. I can use 32 hours into your hourly, into 52 to arrive at your annual income. And I can use that income because your number of hours are still guaranteed, although they are lower than actual, but they're still guaranteed. And that's being confirmed by employment letter and a call to the employer. However, if that said, you are on reduced hours now, and there's no guarantee as to how many hours are you going to work, it'll depend on how much work does the company have. That does make the situation very tricky. So in that case, we would have to kind of you know, go in further and inspect further to find out if there is a date on which the employee is expected to return to full-time work. We can try to get you an exception and get you approved with your full income. As long as before closing, we can confirm to the lender that you're going to return to full-time work. But this is all going to be case by case. So for all those people who've been thinking, oh, I'm on reduced hours or my income has reduced, my salary has been reduced because of COVID, and I wouldn't qualify, that's not the case. There are solutions still available and lenders are willing to work with you. So that was the point there. What happens if you're temporarily laid off? Now, if you're temporarily laid off, it does make the situation very, very hard, and we may have to wait for you to resume work. You know, and once you resume work, we'd have to wait for you to get a new employment letter and a pay stub. On the B side, we may try to get an exception if there is a date again, because I have worked with a couple of people where they said, oh, I'm temporarily laid off, but I have an employment letter that states that I'm going to be back to full-time work starting the 3rd of August. I can try to put a deal in with a B lender and say, okay, you know what? They're going to be back to work on 3rd of August, and I'll send you a confirmation of the same thing. That may or may not fly. We can certainly try. With the banks, though, I think if you're laid off temporarily, you'd have to resume full-time work before we can put your application in the system. Self-employed clients. Now, this is where things have changed a little bit. So with regards to self-employed clients, basically, here's how it works. For a bank and any of the other non-banking prime institutions, they're going to look at the average of your last 2 years' net income. Some people would also call it the line 150 income. I shy away from calling it line 150 income because there are other types of incomes included in line 150, which we may or may not be able to include. But let's just take it net income after writing off all expenses. The average of the last 2 years is what the banks are looking at. What they're doing now, though, they also want to see what you're doing year to date. So let's say your average of 2018 and 2019 was $100,000 net income, which is amazing, and we can work on your mortgage. But in 2020, you've only done about $20,000 in the end of June, which means you're only tracking about $40,000 for the year. Now, that is going to be a question, because $40,000 gross income would not give us a lot of net income. So that could be challenging, and we have to work with self-employed clients and make sure that, you know, we set expectations correctly. There are then B lenders, on the other hand, the non-prime lenders or the subprime lenders. The subprime lenders are okay to work with your 6 months bank statements. So they'd look at your most recent income and they'll work with you accordingly. You can state your income with subprime lenders. So for those people who did not know, our subprime lenders allow stated income program. Basically, what that means is we look at your 6 months bank statements, multiply that by two to annualize the income, and then we state the expenses. So these expenses don't have to coincide with what you're putting on your taxes. These are expenses that you think are kind of fair based on the type of industry you are in and the kind of business or the volume that you're doing. And then we state that, and if that income works with the lenders, they would allow you to work with that, with the stated income program. So that is certainly still open. However, what's also happened, and you know, we can discuss that during our first conversation if someone wants to ever call me, is the industry type. So restaurants are now opening up. So I think that one industry is now fine. But we've had cases back in May or June where certain industries are not being entertained by either the A lenders or the B lenders. As an example, I had a borrower who owns a banquet hall. And back in May, you did not know the future of a banquet hall owner as to what's going to happen to their business, etc. So although their business was very strong in 2018 and 19, and the amount of income was over $500,000 gross revenue, we could still not make it work because people were not just looking at income. Now they were concerned about the industry. Mm-hmm. However, I think things are changing gradually, and people are okay with restaurants now. Lenders are okay with restaurants now that they're opening up. Banquet halls, we can give it a shot and we can see, because now that we are allowed a gathering of 50 plus people, banquet hall business may start picking up again. So we kind of wait and watch as to what happens there. If you are a contractual employee, what happens with a contractual employee? It's the same as before. We'd need your 2 year average income. There are certain banks that I work with who would also give you exceptions. So if you don't have a 2 year average, but you know, there's some history that we can track back to. Let me give you an example. I have this client who was working with a company and he was the IT specialist there. And then he decided that he's going to start contracting. So he got into a contract position, and because the amount of income he could make increased many folds. But he did not have full 2 years of experience, which a lot of other banks would ask for. So, however, I could get him an exception based on his history, and then we could use his recent income to qualify the deal. So that is still possible. However, if you have no history, again, I have another deal here where my client was working with a contact center. He was new to Canada, working at a contact center. And then he started contracting with a big government company. It was a one-year contract. So the contract has still not been renewed. The 1 year is not up yet. And what my lenders are telling me is we'll have to wait for the renewal to happen. Because unless the renewal has happened, they are not sure if the contract is going to be renewed given COVID-19. But once the first renewal happens, then at least they know that there's a background or there's a history for them to kind of fall back upon and see that, okay, this guy is stable. So again, case by case.
So I have a question.
Sure.
So there's a question here. Now, what happens if someone's on probation? They switch jobs. Okay. In the same field, let's say, still in the same field, yeah. But they switch job and now they're in probation.
Right. So their probation will have to end before closing. So let's say they started the job right now. Their probation is 3 months long. They can certainly go out, look for a property. I can even get them a conditional approval. But there'd be a condition that I'll have to give them a proof of confirmation or that they've become now a permanent employee and the probation is over before the closing date. So I'd say you should put the closing date about 15, 20 days after the probation date, mm-hmm. because it's not always instantly that you get a letter from your employer. It can take a couple of days. So I'd keep that buffer.
Now that applies even if, let's say you change a complete job with a different field or like in the same field.
Yeah,
like,
it doesn't matter. If you're full-time permanent and if you're not contractual, then your history does support the application, but if you're going into a completely unrelated field, it does not reduce your chances of being qualified because they're still seeing you full-time permanent. It's only with contractual and the fact that we have to get exceptions. That's when we are looking at past history to kind of, you know, back up our case of getting an exception for the client.
Okay.
Awesome. So a couple of other changes. Now, employment documents, like I said, with full-time permanent employees or any of the other employees, we need about 14, an employment letter and a pay stub for sure to get you qualified and confirm your employment. However, all the lenders or most of the lenders are now requesting that all these letters be dated within 14 days of application. So this, again, this does not affect your qualification in any way, but the only thing is, it could be a little bit of extra work. As some of my partners would know, when we start, I do ask for this documentation to get you a pre-approval as an example. But if that documentation is now old, I could use it back in the day. But now I'd have all that documentation to be reproduced and dated within the last 14 days of.
So this is for the pre-approval or?
For firm approvals.
For firm approval. Okay,
so it used to be, as well.
It used to be like 3 months back.
What's that?
Like you used to can get it like 3 months back, right? But now the banks are asking 14 days, right?
Yeah. So there were situations back in the day where let's say I got you a pre-approval in January mm-hmm. and you submitted your employment letter and pay stub. I'm fine with that. But you actually purchased in March and then all you did was you gave me a recent pay stub. I could still use the old employment letter of yours from January.
Okay.
Now I would have to have the employment letter as well as the pay stub to be dated within 14 days of the application when I'm making the application form for you.
Okay.
So that's that. And in terms of self-employed individuals, even the banks some of the banks have started asking for bank statements now. And again, that's just to track what your year to date is. So back in the day, the banks would be like, oh, that's your 2018 and 2019 tax returns. That's your net income. We're good to go. Now they want a confirmation that you're still making enough money. Yes, you may not be tracking the same number as, let's say, the last 2 years. But if there's not a significant variance, we can still go back and explain to the underwriter because they know COVID-19 happened. And once that's out of the way, especially for certain business types, your business is going to go back to normal. So it happened in one of my cases recently where this was a commissioned salesperson for a telecommunication firm. And his year to date was lower than his average of 2018 and 19. But that was fine because now, you know, once people got settled in, this business is going to pick up again. In fact, it's going to pick up more. People are going to need, let's say, more Wi-Fi and, you know, they want to make sure they've got more data now and things like that. So as long as we can explain it, we can still make it work. And what happens if you are, let's say, temporarily laid off? Can I use your CERB, C-E-R-B and EI income? Till about last month, I could actually, with my B lenders, I could use your CERB and EI to qualify. I can't do it anymore. That's just because, you know, CERB has been extended and the lenders don't think that this is something they can consider a permanent source of income anymore.
So even B lenders won't let you know.
Even B lenders won't use it anymore. EI or CERB, they'd want your employment or self-employed income.
Okay.
How have appraisals changed? Any other questions, Nick, about employment before I move to appraisals?
Nothing. I think so far we're good right now.
Awesome. So with appraisals, what happens is that most lenders try to get you a desktop appraisal. Whether you're putting less than 20% down or more than 20% down, what they'd like to do is they've got a software to get valuations of the properties. So let's say if you bought a property for 500 and their software suggests that the property value is indeed 500, they may not request an appraisal because it's desktop approved. So we're still getting that. That's not changed. So, you know, there's information out there where people are saying that, oh, lenders are not, you know, sure about properties anymore. That's not the case. And I think Nick and everybody else would tell you that the real estate market hasn't slowed down. Maybe a blip in April and May, but in June, in fact, it's almost back to its pre-COVID levels.
Yeah.
So desktop appraisals are still going strong. Not all files require an appraisal, but in case a full appraisal is required, then what will happen is that there are two ways in which this can be executed. The first way, which is very, very rare, is where the lenders are okay with you sending photographs of your property to the appraiser. Then the appraiser will do their own bit and get photographs of the exterior from, you know, online sources from the internet. They'll combine it all. They'll combine it with recent sales data and come up with the appraised value of your property. But the more common approach now is where the appraiser is required to visit your property. They'd not go indoors. So they're going to come to your property. They'd look at maybe the curb appeal. They'd look at the front yard. They'd perhaps even go to the backyard. They'd see how the property looks, if there's any glaring problem that they can see from the outside. And once that's completed, they'd do a video call with you. You know, you can decide the platform between you and the appraiser, which could be through Skype, FaceTime, WhatsApp, whatever. And then in the video call, the appraiser would guide you as to how you walk them through the property. So the appraiser would look at the property while you're walking them through. And based on that, and then the comparables for sales information, they'll give you a property value. That's a very, very common approach these days.
So there's a question here. During these times, what kind of properties would require like a full appraisal?
It's a hit and miss because they want to make sure that there's a desktop appraisal, and if the desktop appraisal goes through for any kind of property, they're fine with it. But if the property value comes in lower, because in case of desktop appraisals outside of the GTA, they haven't been updated as much, at least that's my experience. So there are cases when the property is being purchased for $1 million, but the desktop appraisal suggests, let's say, 750. Now that's a major gap, and you may need a full appraisal in that case where, you know, there's a video call happening and the appraiser is coming to your property. But if it's outside of GTA, as a rule of thumb, most properties do need appraisals nowadays because the lenders are more comfortable with GTA right now. Outside of GTA, there may be an appraisal for sure.
Okay.
And let's say if there is a pre-construction property, there's a good likelihood that there'd be an appraisal for that because sometimes it's hard to find comparables. So I have a lot of clients who are buying in Transit City as an example. A couple of them have been asked to do an appraisal. So that and then market rent addendum. So let's say if you have an investment property or you're buying an investment property, we may need to get market rent appraisal done to estimate the amount of rent that you can get on that property. That is always a desktop-based appraisal. So the appraiser would never visit your property. For market rents, they'll do it over the desktop. However, if there is a basement involved, so here's another thing that I wanted to bring up. That's the beauty of having multiple lenders. I have a bank that would include income from your basement, the basement rental, even if the basement is not retrofit. So as long as the basement has a separate entrance, a full kitchen, a full bathroom and a bedroom, they're okay to include the rent. They don't care if the basement is legal or not. And that's on the bank side, prime side, with the best rates. But if that is to be done, then an appraiser will have to actually come into your property and they'll want to see your basement. So that's among the only cases where the appraisers are actually entering your property now.
You're doing like a two-bedroom window and you're renting a room. Let's say
that wouldn't work. So they need like a self-contained unit, which is a basement, or if it's a duplex property of some sort. Wouldn't work with a condo. So one more thing with basement rentals, I get this question quite a lot. I need full kitchen. Some people have kitchenettes. Kitchenettes won't work. So what I mean by kitchenette is they also call it like a wet room, I guess.
Yes.
That sort. Yeah. So kitchenette basically is you have a cooktop and you have a small refrigerator. That wouldn't work. I need a full kitchen.
Okay. And how about if it's not retrofitted? Would that matter?
That wouldn't matter.
That wouldn't matter. Okay.
Yeah. As long as it's self-contained, we are good to go. And we can include that income in the qualifying income. So that helps you qualify for a bigger amount. Some of the other changes. So if you're buying an investment property, the down payment, as you would know, with a bank cannot be gifted. If you're going to a B lender, you can have gifted down payment. But with a bank, your down payment cannot be gifted. It has to be from your own sources, or you can refinance your current property, get a HELOC or something of that sort, and that money can be used. However, with one of my lenders right now, during COVID only, even refinancing is not allowed, and it has to be the down payment has to be from your savings. But again, just to reinforce, it's only with one of my lenders, not every lender. All the other lenders are continuing with their old policy where you could refinance your property, your primary residence, and use it as down payment for an investment property. But here's another thing. Let's say if you are living in a property and you're buying another property to move into that unit, then you can still refinance your current unit and move in there, because now it's not an investment property anymore. It's an owner-occupied property that you're moving into. So then you can refinance your current house, and you can use that money as down payment, which is completely fine.
Okay, very nice.
Response times have slowed down with the lenders. That's something that I generally like to kind of mention up front, you know, to set the expectations. I had lenders who had a response time of 4 hours. So let's say if I put the deal in the system at 9 a.m., I'd have a response by 1 p.m. However, that has changed, and most lenders are now taking anywhere between 2 to 4 working days to respond. And that would come in handy if, let's say, if you're doing a condition of financing, I'd say stick to 5 days. You may be required to do shorter, let's say three days or 2 days in certain cases. Give me a call before you do that in case you're working with me, or give your mortgage broker a call and make sure that the mortgage broker is comfortable with that, because they have an idea as to which lender.
I always do that.
That's the best way forward, right? Because now everyone's on the same page. So that's very important. That's good to keep in mind. Mortgage deferrals. Now, there was so much speculation about what's going to happen with mortgage deferrals. Does that impact my credit in any way? It doesn't impact your credit, but it does impact the likelihood of you getting approved. So I was working with a borrower. They were buying an investment property. Everything was fine. They had full-time employment. They had savings. But when I got their bank statements to confirm their income deposits, I could see that in the first month, there was a payment that went out. But the second month onwards, there was no payment going out, which was very clear that they've deferred their current mortgage. And as soon as you do that, it does kind of put a dent on your qualification. The lenders are concerned because they're like, if you can't pay your current mortgage, how would you afford the second mortgage? It's not a hard stop. There is always a workaround, and we'll perhaps have to resume your current mortgage and tell them that was only a temporary fixture. We've changed it. They're paying their current mortgage, and we can still get it done. But it does kind of affect our process and make it more difficult. However, what's also happened is in only one of the cases I've seen that it's showing up on your credit bureau. So you know how on your credit bureau, it shows that you have a mortgage, this is your mortgage balance, this is your monthly payment. And then right under that, it says deferred program availed. And as soon as it shows up on your credit bureau, it has, although it's not affected your score in any way, but it's certainly a big negative. And when I send the deal out, the lenders are very, very picky about those deals. They don't want to work with somebody who's deferred their mortgage right now, quite obviously. And then, like I said, nothing's a hard stop. We can always go back and forth, negotiate and try to see, okay, what if I resume my payment? It was a temporary fixture. I'm back to full-time work. We can get it done. But it's important to know that that could kind of, you know, be an obstacle in the way. And today more than ever, I'd say it's very, very important to get a pre-approval or pre-qualification done. I've had cases where just yesterday where someone called me, oh, I purchased a property for $725,000. I was like, wonderful. This is my income. And he wouldn't qualify for the entire mortgage that he needs. And I was like, you know, you should have called me, buddy. You should have called me before to run a pre-qualification or a pre-approval, because at least you need to know what your budget is.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of misinformation. Like Nick is an example, you would be surprised. I've had people call me and they're like, oh, I can afford this mortgage. Why can't you qualify me? It's like, I wish I could work that way. But then there's a regulation that I'm following and I have to, you know, work with my ratios and make sure that everyone fits or everything
but,
fits.
But let's say people that bought the pre-construction, seeing that it's not getting built, let's say 3 to 4 years from now,
yeah.
They would have time to, let's say, improve or make it happen, would you say? Absolutely.
If they were buying pre-construction, they have a lot of time to make it happen. They've got 3 years in the process. And if you have a clear idea of things that are going to change, I had another borrower who bought a pre-construction. The mortgage would not work without the wife's income. I told him that upfront. However, the wife had been temporarily laid off. So it's been a couple of months and she's been rehired and now they're good to go. So, you know, if there's like a temporary situation which is holding you back right now, pre-construction could be the way to go, where you know that in the future, your situation is going to improve and you know it for a fact, and it'll work for you.
Okay.
So awesome. That's pretty much it. I've got my information here. And in case you have any questions, you can reach out right now. You can even text or call me later.
Yeah, so no, that's great. Thank you, Mohit, for joining us. And thank you, everyone, that's viewing this video or viewing it later on the recording. I'm going to be sure to basically type this information here on our link on Facebook as well. So if you have any questions, you can give Mohit a call or email, and he'll help you out. He sure helps a lot of my clients out, and I refer him 100% of the time. So
thank you so much.
Thank you, Mohit, for joining us, and I'll see you next time.
Sure. See you. Take care.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.